We'll now directly slip on to the next session, that is the last session for the day, focusing on EPC and O&M of rooftop solar projects, for which I would like to invite, first of all, Mr. Somashekhar, who is the Director and Chief Technology Officer of Avi Solar Energy Private Limited. He'll also be giving a small presentation. Mr. Amit Barve, VP Enerpac Energy, he'll be moderating the session with us. Mr. P.B.A. Paapaarao, Regional South, Regional Head South for Godrej. I think we had a cancellation of Mr. Souri, Raju from Fourth Partner. Then we have Mr. Pasupathy Kumar, who is the CEO and Director of VRM Energy Consultancy Services Private Limited. And if we have Mr. Mahesh Aswathaiya, who is the DGM of Business Development from Juwi India Renewables.
Good afternoon. Well, my name is Somashekhar, call me Soma, from Avi Solar Energy. Now, we are one of the leading O&M service provider in the country, like in different segment here. And today, here in the next 5 to 10 minutes, what I'm going to show you is our experience. Now, we have been managing nearly an gigawatt worth solar assets in India. I'll just show you some of the reality examples. You know, it's good to talk about all the designing issues, and you know, the videos looks good, the photos are fantastic, but we will tell you from our experience what is that, you know, is really happening. We have been talking about 25 years of plant performance. Is it really happening or not? Okay, so the solar revolution in India is just getting out of the honeymoon period. That's what I would really call it as. So gone are the days wherein, as Mr. Sunil Joshi was mentioning, every electrical contractor, every civil contractor who has done the EPC. So let's just think about what is that actually it needs for a plant to run for 25 years successfully, right? So number one point I always say is, you know, choose a competent EPC. It's much more than just putting the structures there and, you know, digging the foundation. There's much more than that. It is, or it may not be, only the L1 guys, I would say, should win the contract. I'm very sure people would realize it shortly, but this is actually the most important thing. The key thing in any EPC, it is more than the equipment. Of course, the equipment is important, but in our experience as O&M, we have seen plants in Gujarat and Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, AP, Telangana, in all the 13 states basically. The workmanship has been the key thing, right? Especially, we have seen these laborers working during night, the cables, the foundations. People don't really know what's underneath the foundation. We have seen structures collapsing like anything. Live, we have seen. I don't want to show it here, but then even from the biggest of the builders, right? Cables are joined underneath. One monsoon comes in, you know where the problem starts, right? So these are the things you will get to know only after a few years. Even if you buy a Mercedes, after 4 years, you need to service it, correct? It's not that you put a plant together and it runs for all 25 years. So workmanship is the key. So ensure that you supervise and inspect the work. Because finally it's subcontracting, 3 or 4 levels of subcontracting, and it's actually your own laborers from the village actually doing the work. Now, very important thing, monitoring. Do not compromise on this. People have purchased very expensive SCADA systems, but we have seen many places they're just lying there. Because either it needed an high bandwidth communication channel. So sometimes they have it working in the control room, but not after that. Now, as you know, our SCADA system, you know, you can just, you know, open your mobile and you can see what's happening, right? And there's another fact, string level monitoring. As you all know, the tariffs has been coming down and people have compromised on all the equipments. They said enough from the inverter, if I get the data, that's good enough for me. But if you want to really see the leakages which is happening in the plant, so I suggest, if there are any developers here, please go for a string level monitoring. In the long run, now anyhow, I don't want to show any maths here, but in the long run, it will be really, really beneficial. So these are the EPC. I'll just show you some not to do stuff later. I'll also talk about operation and maintenance. So there's a myth here. Operation and maintenance means it's grass cutting and module cleaning. You know, people also call it as glorified gardening, right? Which is definitely not the case, right? So this is what actually typically people think of, it's cleaning and vegetation control. Of course, it's important, but our recommendation, beside the cleaning cycle, people just look into either the tender or actually what the management has decided 2 or 3 times a month. You know, sometimes in Rajasthan, we've got plants, you know, people have dictated 3 times. People are suffering, they have their water. And, you know, just to meet the contractual obligations, an O&M service provider is supposed to do this, right? So be conscious about it. Definitely, we don't want people to lose their generation. If you really see that kind of an improvement, we can do it. But things like the dry cleaning are in place. Maybe it does work in northern states, but in Tamil Nadu and Andhra, we have seen, you know, there are more, you know, bird poops than actually anything else, which even the, you know, none of the robotic cleaning systems help them, right? So cleaning is important. Overgrown vegetation, that's important. But some customers, they wanted the plant to look like a resort. That's difficult. Like the grass definitely shouldn't come in, but then if you want to keep an entire 200 acre, 500 acre, you know, like a completely clean shaven land, then that's challenging. So these are things actually we should be careful about. Labors. Labors are important. See, I always tell this, in our company, we have formed a new loss strategy. Like, you know, all the soiling losses, we call it as a towel loss. You know what these laborers who come for the cleaning do? They put their towel on the panels and then start their cleaning work, right? So this is India. We have got many, many more challenges which you don't really see in Western and Western world, right? So the art is totally different here. It's not about the beauty of the plant, it's about the performance and health. Now, what we do, or actually what's important for you to demand from your O&M service providers, is one is identifying and detecting the problems, or as you all know, right, failure responses. So what is that? We need to bring in some metrics. That's important, right? You have the log and actually ensure what is the mean time to detect, how fast you detect the problem. I think that is very important. Sometimes an inverter, not sometimes, you know, all the time, you know that the inverter down for 1 hour or in 30 minutes, you know how much loss actually that can cost to you, right? Then you should have a competent engineer at site. It's very challenging because engineers prefer white collar jobs, they want to be in the city. Finding somebody locally is actually challenging, but then you need to train him, you have to have a trained technician. So that's where, you know, mean time to resolve, we call it. This is the metric we, you know, consider in Avi Solar. Mean time to resolve, how fast actually the problem gets resolved. The third one is, you know, central remote monitoring. Sometimes the site people will overlook some of the aspects, but here somebody as an second option, right, as a plan B, basically in your headquarters, you can be monitoring the plant. This is where I said the inverter monitoring is, the string monitoring is very important. Then you need system experts in-house, right? We have seen the best of the inverters, they promise all kind of guarantees, but when it really fails, they respond to the call, they raise the ticket, but the problem is solved after a very, very long time. Not to blame them, they have got so many installations in hand, they have subcontracted their service, you know, that's their strategy. So it's important to get trained from all these inverter manufacturers and see that at least the basic troubleshooting, we call it as a L1 or L2 levels, can be done actually in-house, but or by your own technicians. Again, these problems will be very, very prominent as your plant gets more than 3 to 4 years old. First 2 years, everything is fantastic. You clean the module, you are done. Then preventive maintenance. So how do we do this, preventive maintenance, right? Of course, as part of our O&M checklist, there are actually checklist items. Day in, day out, the engineer will validate all these things, you know, including, for example, on the transformer oils, right from the switchyard and the inverter, they open the door. And as you know, it's on remote location, the rodents just flow inside your inverter room. There will be snakes, there will be all sorts of stuff, right? So preventive maintenance is extremely important, and monitor and analyze the data. See, sometimes the small leakages, you don't see it, you know, it's not an actually direct, you won't see when 3 or 4 strings are down. So you just look into the pattern, right? Compare the performance ratios and validate the insulations. So it's very important to analyze the data as well. So summarize here, O&M is a technical activity, so please just don't depend on your house cleaning staff. Please have some engineers or technical person at site. That's the appeal, right? So some of the things actually I just want to show you, some of our example, I don't want to name any of the plants, but how designing is very important. See, in this particular case here, you can see that actually it is just really heating up the cables. That's because it's stretched so much. The SLD doesn't say actually how to lay the cable. So I was talking about workmanship, right? So why an EPC work is important. So finally, what happens there, right? See, then over the period of time here, actually it's really getting black, darker, and one day you see this, it's the cable is gone. Now you need to replace it, and it's actually a hell of a lot of work to do all these tasks, right? These are actually 185, 240 square mm cables, right? So some other things. Module design, sorry, the structure design, fantastic. Everything works in CAD or SolidWorks, superb. But look at how the tables have been laid. They are not considered enough. What should be the height criteria from the ground, right? In all our videos or actually in the plants, we see, you know, the tractors moving in between rows and it's all beautiful. But in reality, I think Amit is, you know, really smiling. In reality, the terrain is very, very difficult. And we don't bother because we have a deadline to meet. EPC project team actually has to hand over the project to the O&M team. So land leveling cancelled, half feet above, it's okay. So that is the impact. Look at the losses what we'll have in the later, correct? Right. So next, major things, the MC4 connectors, right? So typically what we do, from the string, the cable goes into a combiner box and then to the inverter. Now, the tariffs fell down, EPC prices has to drop, people came up with first Y connector, right? Two cables are combined, becomes a Y connection and then goes in there. But they did just calculate what should be my cable size when the current has increased, right? And they've chosen all sort of Y connectors. They've started combining three or four strings and making one bunch. The result is that, you know, everywhere it's all catching fire. Slowly the degradation is happening. This, do you think the cleaning staff will understand? Never. But this can be really catastrophic. We have seen the huge, you know, the fire actually once broke out right underneath the modules. And in summer, it's extremely dangerous. The entire cable can be burnt out and the losses are very, very huge, right? So please be aware, there is a lot of technical stuff here. Hotspots. We say drone is good enough and all that. You know what? We have seen actually, you know, these kind of things underneath the panels. We don't know how, but we are seeing this. So 25 US guarantee, wonderful, beautiful to talk about. But let us see, there are actually much more things than 25 years warranty, right? The degradation, the kind of degradation happening in the module. Well, of course, we haven't seen the numbers dropping down, by the way. But these physical damages actually are scary, right? This is one thing, the hotspots from the underneath. So this we don't know actually, no? It should be even when the people, some places, they glass cutter, maybe a stone has actually felt up. What we see, a hole right through the panels. This is another impact, snail trail. I think many of you would have heard about this, right? In one of our 10 megawatt plant, we have already seen 80% of the top tire companies in China, okay, 80% are infected with so-called snail trails. Generation we analyzed, no issues as of now, but when doing hotspot analysis, we are really seeing hotspots. So solutions are yet to come. So just don't relax, check it out, whether your plant is infected. Now, again, we are actually consulting experts, but one of the cause they say is the back paper, actually what we use in the panels, right? The moisture enter into the thing. That's again speculated, so don't quote me there. We need to really find the solutions for this or actually consult the experts, right? So again, this is we do an analysis, a thermal imaging, correct? Which does show that, you know, wherever these kind of unusual things which are seen on the panel, we do see some degradations happening there, right? So my appeal, don't be penny wise and pound foolish. When you have constructed a plant of so many crores, we have seen, you know, people talking about O&Ms of, you know, for 1 megawatt, 2 lakhs, and all. That's the kind of discussion happening in the market. Of course, we need to save money, I don't deny that, but ensure that you do give time and analyze if the O&M is necessary or not. So that's all I had. Over to you.
Thanks, Soma. It was a wonderful presentation. Very, very informative. Yeah, it's a real wonderful start for the panel to take it forward. I would like to now request Mr. Pasupathy Kumar. You have a presentation, so you can do the presentation and brief introduction, and then we.
Good afternoon. So thanks for the wonderful opportunity given to us by the organizers, and I would like to thank my guy who has explained more details about the EPC and what are the difficulties we face. Actually, that's a very eye-opener, and let us also start in line with him. And we are EPC company basically, and we have done nearly 40 megawatts of projects across the country, and I in my personal this one I have executed nearly 50 megawatt, and we have an experience of nearly eight years of experience in the O&M also. So I was really happy when I saw his slides regarding the O&M, and I will back to you for the this one also, sir. Thank you. So VRM energy, we are into the EPC. Let me just go through the slides. First of all, the opportunities in the rooftop and large scale project, there is an excellent opportunity in the solar field. So we don't have to worry for the any this one has to be the entrepreneurs, either we can able to get the orders for this month, and what about the order. So in my opinion, there are fantastic orders, fantastic opportunities are in rooftop and large scale. There are a lot of upcoming projects are there. So there is a wonderful opportunity for all of us, including EPC players, module manufacturers, then inverter guys, everyone, there is an opportunity in the field. These are all the things everybody shared in the morning also. So let us just go to the this one. Actually, the rooftop, yes, we have. You can able to do installation in any kind of roof, except that asbestos sheet. Yeah, apart from that, any kind of roof or any this one, he can able to find some kind of an innovative method to fix without making damage to the roof. These are all few of our installation. Yeah, like he told, what are all the things we need to focus in the rooftop? First of all, the initial design. So if you are in a hurry, just go and fix the panels and install it before the end of March, we have to finish the project. So if you do it in a hurry, without making the proper design, you will really end up with some disaster. Like last year, we have faced the Varda storm, and I am happy to tell that none of our installation faced any problem. So we have to make the initial design. If it is perfect, so you don't need to worry for the for the rest of the time. So wind speed, that is number one. Then while doing the installation, we have to ensure that we are not making any damage to the roof or the water leak, because the factory, which is in operation for years together, and you go and install the solar plant afterwards, if they found the water dripping in the shop floor, it's a very embarrassment, and you are disturbing the existing setup. And while installing the solar this one on the roof, we have to ensure that leaving a efficient space in between the panel, because later stage, after 1 year, you may need to replace the panel, or you need to walk down in between to wash the panel. Then before you start installing the panel, you have to ensure the strength of the this one, because you will be applying such a load on the building, and it has to withstand the and we have to distribute the load and ensure that the existing building strength should be with. And the next thing is, we have to ensure there is no any nearby high-rise building. So if it is there, the area just one of installing solar and the buildings has been gone. Then the next important this one is interconnecting with the existing LT and HT feeder. Any people are making the mistakes in this one. I will order all the materials, and while installation with the dead with the live buffer, they will see, oh, this is ET ratio is 100/5. Oh boss, this I thought it's 100/1. So if your design is good, so you have to do the interconnection with the existing LT and HT feeder without any mistake. Then what we offer at VRM, we have an engineering team, professional engineering team, safety at work. because we are all working on high-rise building, high-rise roof, so we need to ensure there is no any accident, there is no any injury to the both in and for the material. And lot of places we have found there is no ladder, people are working in the straight sunlight for a long time, so we have to ensure the working atmosphere also. Then laying of cables, earth strip from a lot of heights. Then after you do the installation, the how to reach the place every time to do the ensure the system is working perfect, then interconnection with your feeders. Then these are all a few installations you can just see. Matsu at Oragadam, it's a repeat order, we have done a 50-50 kilowatt. These are all the railway projects we did. These are all in view of the roof. Aluminium and as well as MMS. Cochin Airport, that 15 megawatt, it's a very good project. And afterwards, the West Bengal also airport, they have given the DPR, design analysis. We are doing everything. We have four verticals. One vertical is EPC. Yes, our other vertical is we are doing design and engineering and doing the DPR, making for the big projects. In fact, for one of the NLC project, we are doing 100 megawatt DPR. This is one of the net metering. People are asking about net metering. This is one of the net metering, but not in our state. It's in our neighboring states. Their net meters are without any issue. You just go and apply the next. I will give a receipt, this date you need to pay the money, then the meter will come, it has to go to a laboratory, we need to do the recalibration, then just install it, the engineers will come, MRT team will come, finish the work. Monitoring system, that rightly told, we have to check and ensure our production of electricity in line with our design, and every time we can able to watch any part of the world. Then installation should be done by a professional team, not by a local electrician who has little knowledge and he goes and he make a mistake, then it will end up with a big this one. So we should have our own team, that in-house electrical team who can able to do this at installation. Then the next important thing is to get the approval from electricity authority and from DISCOM. This is not a normal job. This we are doing it. This job also we are doing as in our EPC, that we have some retired staff from the respective department to handle the respective teams, to get the approvals, to get the inspections them, to get the net metering and installation, everything. These are all in airport. This is a 1 megawatt site at airport, Ashok Leyland site, Boriano project. Then this Raj Bhavan. Entire Raj Bhavan is done with our 400 kilowatt site in this rapid action force in Mumbai. Yeah, this is the harbor site which he was asking, no? Fortress site. Because the near to the harbor, that air and plus also the dust level is very horrible dust because of hundreds of truck movement and other thing. Plus near to the sea, that the moisturized salt content, that air is coming and it is coming and making the structures rusted like anything. So the hot dip what we made is the 120 micron. The railways, and we are happy to tell that we are doing a lot of projects for railways. These are all the Hubli and other railway projects. Yeah, then the next day, this one everybody talks is the Moot model also we are doing. We have some investors lined up. For that, we need some good client with some the CRISIL rating, or maybe of the higher CRISIL rating, we can able to do it. Then comes the important chapter for the O&M. O&M, as he rightly told, we have to use the engineers to do the O&M and all, but it's all correct. But in the reality, at what peak, what money we are getting from our end client for doing the O&M is very, very less. So within that funds, you have to run your show, you have to take the reading of the meter, and you have to do the washing of the plant every once in a month or maybe twice in the month, and in between some inverter tripping, in between some LT cable problem. These are all you have to handle with that available resources. So it is always resources versus you have, then you can deploy the team over there. As you rightly told, up to this one we need to watch. Then DISCOM issues, then DISCOM means there will be intermittent, some trippings will be there at HT level or 11 kV level or 40 level at DISCOM. So we need to interact with the DISCOM team and we need to make the this one. Then the washing frequency team, proper equipments we need to use. I team, they should be kept proper equipment, tools and other thing to operate the this one. That's all. The rest is not our list of clients. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pasupathy. Thanks for giving informative on the organization and the projects that you have done. Now I request Mr. Paapaarao from Godrej to give a brief introduction about himself and the work that you are doing at Godrej.
Hi, good evening, everybody. We thank EQ International for giving us an opportunity. I'm Paapaarao. I'm the regional head for Godrej Solar Division. Godrej is a $20 billion company comprising of several multi-diverse manufacturing activities. We have diversified into solar about 5 years back, and we have more done rooftop projects, and recently we have done the ground-mounted project also. And Godrej, as we are a 120-year-old brand, we focus more on quality and reliability than the getting more orders. Our, in fact, even today, the major orders are coming through our repeat customers. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Paapaarao. I'll do a short presentation from my side and then we will go on to the question answer session. I'll keep my presentation very light. I think so all of you have been through the entire day. I'll keep it very light and very simple and then we'll go to the question answer.
So, good evening everybody. My name is Amit Barve and I represent Enerpac Energy. All of you must be wondering what this Breaking 2 is. Is anybody aware about what the Breaking 2 project was? No? Okay, fine. So, running is my second passion beyond solar. Solar is definitely the first passion. And that's the reason I follow this sport. And Breaking 2 was a project which was conceived by a sports apparel company, Nike. The aim of this project was to break a 2 hours barrier, and that was the reason it was called as a Breaking 2. Running 42 kilometers, a full marathon, within a time frame of 2 hours, that's the project which was conceived. The world record as of now is of 2 hours and 2 minutes to run a 42 kilometers, and no athletes have been unable to break this record for long years, and that's the reason this company took over this challenge of breaking this record by putting certain special efforts. The event was done on 5th of May in a place called as Monza in Italy, which is a racing track actually, which was used to do this feat. Now, all of you must be wondering for last 2 to 3 minutes, what does Breaking 2 has a relevance with the solar sector actually, yeah? We are here for a solar conference and what does it resemble? So, just to remind all of us, we are also having a Breaking 2 challenge, which we already have taken. But Breaking 2 into 50 gigawatt, that is 100 gigawatt of a target as a part of a national solar mission that we want to achieve. This is the target which got revised after the new government came and things have started moving ahead. And today I'll just briefly say what is the progress, what are the bottlenecks and how the things are happening in this program. This was the actual photograph of the event. You can say there was a vehicle which was leading all the athletes who were running to showcase the timing and pace at which they are running. You can also see a laser-guided triangle, which was like if an athlete is running within that triangle at that pace, he is likely to finish the race within less than 2 hours. But you will be surprised, the number of people who are running, they were all not competing. Many of the people who are in the black t-shirt were the pacers actually, not the actual runners. And they were just leading the actual runners to catch up onto the pace for the entire running. And they were actually moving out every 10th of kilometer and new pacers were coming again with a full energy running at a fast pace to take the leading race. So that was the arrangement. My point here is that today we have a target of 20 gigawatt. We have to have a pace. We have to have a consistency. Today what is happening is the project tenders are not happening in the phase which have been planned. The pace is not getting maintained. The frequency of RFQs coming out is really invariable, which is actually leading the project developers to become restless. They have got so many people on the board. They have a huge targets which they have committed to their investors. And if the tenders don't come, as and when come, there is a huge aggression, which is leading to basically a very low tariff, which will also become an eventually a problem executing such projects at a level where you can maintain the quality. And ultimately, if you do not maintain the quality, the life itself may not be 25 years. We have seen ample examples, what Soma already shown us. And the confidence in the entire sector will start derailing if the sites don't perform to the expectation. So the point what I wanted to drive here is we really need to maintain a pace. We need to maintain that momentum to see that we are able to reach to that target of 100 gigawatt by 2022. Today we keep hearing about a lot of issues in solar sector. I think so there have been, since morning we have been hearing about duty problem in customs duty coming through, anti-dumping duty coming through, safeguard duty coming through. So policy makers are also in a different world, they are trying to do something. But the good part probably we need to see is that when I started working in solar industry, I did it in 2003, which was pretty early, like 14 years back. We were selling the systems at 350 rupees per watt peak. From there, today we have come down below, I think, so 40 rupees. Volumes have gone up. So something good has been done by policymakers. It's not that everything is bad. Today we have reached to the level of 20 gigawatt cumulative capacity. Has also been because of the policy decisions which have been taken. So certain decisions may not be benefiting right now, but it doesn't mean that we should not cooperate, collaborate, work together. It is all our shared responsibility to make this mission happen. There are various stakeholders. There are policymakers, there are developers, there are EPC companies, there are O&M companies, and all of us need to play our role as a common vision, as a shared vision and shared responsibility. That is exactly what the entire Nike team did. Yeah, if you see the pictures, these were the team members. There were 25 members who were a part of this team. People or the athletes were the ones only who were running. But there was a team behind the runners. They were sports psychologists, nutritionists, sports doctorates, ground people to prepare the ground for them to run. So there was a plethora of team which was actually managing the show and managing the show for entire 1 year to prepare for the event. That is exactly what we need to have as a shared vision and shared responsibility, that all of us together need to work to see that we achieve the target. The thing was, if you see, these were the three athletes who actually competed, even though there were so many people who were running. The target was to train these three athletes. One is Mr. Kipchoge, Tarsi, and the third one is called as Desisa. All of them have been accomplished athletes. Like Kipchoge has won 7 or 8 international marathon races. He is a Rio gold medalist for the marathon. Other two guys have been doing the half marathon and world record holder as well as gold medalist. They're earning in millions as an athlete actually, yeah? But still they took over the challenge of running and trying to break something which was different. So adoption is a key. Challenges will be there. They went through the grueling session of more than 1 year to prepare for this event actually. So my point is that everything will have its own set of problems. Every stakeholder will see it's a problem, but till the time we all don't adopt it and try to work around it, things will never happen. If we just sit around in the comfort zone, as what Mr. Sunil was also saying, if everybody of us contribute in some way or the other, I think so there are ways and means and possibilities will be created to see that we move ahead onto the solar sector. Last, I think so all of you would be also excited to know what happened actually. On the 5th of May, the race did complete. Out of three athletes, actually, two of them could not consistently maintain that pace and they have to bow out actually. Yeah. And only Kipchoge, who is already a world record holder for the Rio gold medalist, actually completed in 2 hours and 23 seconds. So he missed the target only by 23 seconds actually. Yeah. But if we really see that all of us work together, all of us work in a tandem, make full-fledged efforts and work towards the goal, I don't think so a target of Making 100 gigawatt is impossible. And that's what the rival brand of Nike Adidas says, impossible is nothing. Yeah, and that is what we should all work towards to make this solar mission work. So this was all about my presentation. I'll just brief you about my company, Enerpac. Enerpac is a German headquartered company out of Hamburg. We are a solar IPP as well as an EPC company. We have done close to 2 gigawatt of grid connections. We have our own assets of 1.1 gigawatt on our own books. And we are maintaining close to 1.4 gigawatt of assets worldwide over and above our own gigawatts. In India, we have done a couple of marquee projects, including Delhi International Airport, as well as Hyderabad International Airport, as well as a couple of rooftop projects. These are some of our reference clients with whom we keep working on a regular basis. And that's all from my side. I'll be here to take your questions as well as lead to the panel discussions further. Thank you so much.